It's very good to be here. It's good to be anywhere, considering I died in 1973. Tonight, I propose to speak about fairy stories. Though I'm aware that this is a rash adventure, fairy is a perilous realm, and in it are pitfalls for the unwary and dungeons for the overbold. But please bear with me in this lecture as I prepare to be perhaps somewhat overbold. Fairy stories, on the whole, have three faces: the mystical towards the supernatural, the magical towards nature, and the mirror of scorn and pity towards man. In addition, the realm of fairy is wide and deep and high and is filled with many things. All manner of beasts and birds are found there, shoreless seas and stars unnumbered. Beauty that is an enchantment and an ever-present peril, both joy and sorrow, as sharp as swords. Into that realm a man may perhaps count himself fortunate to have wandered, but its very richness and strangeness tie the tongue of the traveler who would report. And while he is there, it is dangerous for him to ask too many questions, lest the gates should be shut and the keys lost. There are, however, some questions that one who is to speak about fairy stories must expect to answer, or attempt to answer, whatever the folk of fairyland may think of his impertinence. For instance, one, what are fairy stories? Two, what is their origin? And three, what is the use of them? I will try to give answers to these questions, or such hints of answers to them, as I have gleaned. Begin with the question, what are fairy stories? I answer that they are not stories about particular elves or fairies, but about fairyland, the perilous realm itself, and the air that blows in that country. They are about the realm or state in which fairies have their being. Fairyland contains many things, besides elves and fays, besides dwarves, witches, trolls, giants, and dragons. It holds the seas, the sun, the moon, the sky, and the earth, and all things that are in it, tree and bird, water and stone, wine and bread, and ourselves, mortal men, when we are enchanted. I will speak more about enchantment later. But first, if we are to be clear about what fairy stories are, we also have to be clear about what they are not. There are many stories which are considered fairy tales which should not be considered so because they are not about the perilous realm. Gulliver's voyage to Lilliput, for instance, is often included in collections of fairy stories for no good reason other than the fact that the Lilliputians are small, even diminutive, the only way in which they are at all remarkable. But smallness is, in the realm of fairy as in our world, only an accident. Pygmies are no nearer to fairies than our Patagonians. Tales that deal with the strangeness of the unenchanted earth, however unique or clever, such as Gulliver's Travels, are travelers' tales. But I would exclude them from the category of fairy stories. Next to travelers' tales, I would also exclude any story that uses the machinery of dream, the dreaming of actual human sleep, to explain the apparent occurrence of its marvels. A real dream may indeed be a fairy story of almost elvish ease and skill while it is being dreamed. But if a waking writer tells you that his tale is a thing imagined in his sleep, he cheats deliberately. The primal desire at the heart of fairyland, the realization independent of the conceiving mind, of imagined wonder. For it is essential to a genuine fairy story that it should be presented as true. The meaning of true in this connection I will explain later, but first, since the fairy story deals with marvels, it cannot tolerate any frame or machinery suggesting that the whole tale in which they appear is a figment or illusion. Fairyland may be an enchanted land, but in the context of the story, it is real. As to the question, what is the origin of fairy stories? I think it is more important, and in its way more difficult, to consider what they are, what they have become for us, and what values the long alchemic processes of change have produced in them than it is to speculate about their origins. Three things: independent invention, inheritance, and diffusion have evidently combined to produce the intricate web of story. It is now beyond all skill but that of the elves to unravel it. Of these three, inheritance, which is borrowing in time, diffusion, which is borrowing in space, and invention, which is storycraft, but more than that. Of these three, invention is the most important and fundamental, and so not surprisingly also the most mysterious. To an inventor, that is to a story maker, the other two must in the end turn back. Philology, too, has its role in the origin of fairy stories. For language and its development cannot be dismissed. You see, the incarnate mind, the tongue, and the tale are in our world coeval. The human mind, endowed with the powers of generalization and abstraction, sees not only green grass, distinguishing it from other things and finding it fair to look upon, but also sees that it is green, as well as being grass. But how powerful, how stimulating to the very faculty which produced it was the invention of the adjective. No spell or incantation in fairyland is more potent, and this is not surprising, for such incantations may only be seen as another view of adjectives, as part of speech, in a mythical grammar, the mind that thought of the adjectives. Light, heavy, gray, yellow, still, swift, also considered magic that could make heavy things light and able to fly, turn gray, lead into yellow, gold, or the still, rock, into a swift water. If it could do one, it could do the other. It inevitably did both. You see, when we can take green from grass, blue from heaven, and red from blood, we have already an enchanter's power upon one plane. And the desire to wield that power in the world external to our minds awakes. It does not follow that we shall use that power well upon any plane. We may put a deadly green upon a man's face and produce a horror. We may make the rare and terrible blue moon to shine, or cause woods to spring with silver leaves, or rams to wear fleeces of gold, or put hot fire into the belly of the cold worm, producing the dragon. But in such fantasy, as it is called, new form is made. Man, the story maker, becomes a sub-creator. I will now turn to the third and most important of the three questions. What, if any, are the values and functions of fairy stories now? Are they to be read and enjoyed merely by children, or may they be enjoyed by adults as well? And if enjoyed by adults, what is the nature of this enjoyment? Is it frivolous and so-called escapist? Or is there something more serious and even mystical in the tales of the perilous realm? To answer that question, let us consider another question. What happens when we hear or read a compelling story, any compelling story? What happens when we are drawn in? That state of mind has been called willing suspension of disbelief. But to me, this does not seem to be a good description of what happens. What really happens is the story maker proves a successful sub-creator. He makes a secondary world that your mind can enter. Inside it, what he relates is true. It accords with the laws of that world. You therefore believe it while you are, as it were, inside. The moment disbelief arises, the magic, or rather the art, is broken. You are then out in the primary world again, looking at the little abortive secondary world from the outside. If you are required by kindness or circumstance to stay, then disbelief must be suspended or stifled, otherwise listening and looking would become intolerable. Thus, this suspension of disbelief is a substitute for the genuine thing, or a subterfuge that we use when condescending to games or make-believe, or when trying to find, more or less willingly, what value we can in a work of art that for us is fake. I will give you an example. You have something called baseball in this country. We have cricket in England. I'm not really fond of either. But a real enthusiast for cricket is in the enchanted state secondary belief. When I watch a match, am on the lower level. I can achieve more or less willing suspension of disbelief when I am held there and supported by some other motive that will keep away boredom. For instance, a wild heraldic preference for the light blue uniforms of the Oxford team rather than the dark blue uniforms of the Cambridge team. And so this suspension of disbelief may be a somewhat tired, shabby, sentimental state of mind, but I fancy it is often the state of adults in the presence of a fairy story. They are held there and supported by sentiment, memories of childhood, or notions of what childhood ought to be like. They think they ought to like the tale. But if they really liked it, they would not have to suspend disbelief. They would believe, in this sense. When I was a child, I had no special wish to believe. I wanted to know. Belief depended upon the way in which stories were presented to me by older people or by the authors or on the inherent tone and quality of the tale. But at no point do I recall that the enjoyment of a story was dependent upon belief that such things could happen or had happened in real life. But you see, fairy stories were plainly not primarily about possibility, but about desirability. If they awakened desire, satisfying it, while sometimes quenching it almost unendurably, they succeeded. It's not necessary to be more explicit here, for I hope to say something later about this desire. A complex of many things, some universal, some particular to modern men, including modern children, some even to certain kinds of men. For instance, I had no desire to have dreams or adventures like Alice, and the amount of them merely amused me. I had very little desire to hunt for buried treasure or fight pirates. Treasure Island left me cool. Red Indians were better, for there were bows and arrows. I had and have a wholly unsatisfied desire to shoot well with a bow, and strange languages and glimpses of an archaic mode of life, and above all, forests in such stories. But the land of Merlin and Arthur were better than these. And above all was the nameless north of Sigurd and the Volsungs and the prince of all dragons. Such lands were preeminently desirable. Now, I never imagined that the dragon was of the same order as the horse. And this is not solely because I saw horses daily, never even the footprint of a worm. The dragon had the trademark of fairyland written plain upon him. In whatever world he had his being, it was an other world. Fantasy, the making or glimpsing of other worlds, was at the heart of the desire of fairyland. And I desired dragons with a profound desire. Of course, I and my timid body did not wish to have them in the neighborhood. Intruding into my relatively safe existence, in which, for instance, it was possible to read stories in peace of mind, free of fear. But the world that included even the imagination of Fafnir was richer and more beautiful at whatever cost of peril.
for the dweller in the quiet and fertile plains. May hear of the troubled hills and unharvested seas, and long for them in his heart. For the heart is hard and courageous, though the body be soft and cowardly. I have said perhaps more than enough on this subject, but at least it will be plain that in my view, fairy stories should not be specially associated with children. I do not deny that there is truth in Andrew Lang's words, sentimental though they may be. Quote, he who would enter into the heart of the kingdom of fairy must have the heart of a little child. For having the heart of a little child is necessary to all high adventure. Into kingdoms both less and far greater than the realm of fairy. Very well then. If adults are to read and enjoy fairy stories as a natural branch of literature, then what are the values and functions of that kind? I think this is the last and most important question. I've already hinted at some of my answers. First of all, if written with art, the prime value of fairy stories is that value which, as literature, they share with other literary forms. But fairy stories offer also, in a peculiar degree or mode, these things. One, fantasy. Two, recovery. Three, escape. And four, and most mysteriously, consolation. I will now talk about these four aspects, and I will begin with fantasy. Fantasy is, as I think, not a lower but a higher bar. Indeed, the most nearly pure. So that when successful, also the most powerful. Of course, fantasy starts out with an advantage, arresting strangeness. But this advantage has been turned against it and has contributed to its disrepute. Many people dislike being arrested. They dislike any meddling with the primary world or such glimpses of it as are familiar to them, and they therefore stupidly and even maliciously confound fantasy with dreaming, in which there is no art, or with mental disorders, in which there is not even control, with delusion or hallucination. But this error or malice engendered by disquiet and consequent dislike, is not the only cause of the confusion, for fantasy has also an essential drawback. It is difficult to achieve. Fantasy may be, as I think, not less but more sub-creative, but in any event, as is often found in practice, that the inner consistency of reality is more difficult to produce in fantasy. It is easier to produce this reality with more sober material. Fantasy, thus, too often remains undeveloped. It has been used frivolously or only half-seriously or merely for decoration. It remains merely fanciful. Anyone inheriting the fantastic device of human language can say, the green sun. Many can then imagine a picture, but that is not enough. To make a secondary world inside which the green sun is credible, commanding secondary belief, will probably require labor and thought and will certainly demand special skill, a kind of elvish craft. Few attempt such difficult tasks, but when they are attempted and in any degree accomplished, then we have a rare achievement in art, indeed narrative art in its primary and most potent mode. In human art, fantasy is a thing best left to true literature, that is, to words. In painting, for instance, the visual depiction of the fantastic image is technically too easy. The hand tends to outrun the mind, even to overthrow it. Silliness and morbidity are frequent results. It is a misfortune that drama, an art fundamentally distinct from literature, is so often confused with it. But drama is naturally hostile to fantasy. Men dressed up as talking animals may achieve buffoonery or mimicry, but they cannot achieve fantasy. The reason for this is, of course, partly due to the fact that the makers or producers of drama have to or try to work with mechanism to represent either fantasy or magic. You see, I once saw a children's pantomime, the straight story of Puss in Boots, with even the transformation of the ogre into a mouse. on stage. Had this been mechanically successful, it would either have terrified the spectators or else been just a turn of high-class conjuring. As it was, though done with some ingenuity of lighting, disbelief had not so much to be suspended as hanged, drawn, and quartered. A reason I think more important than the inadequacy of stage effects is this. Drama has already attempted a kind of bogus, or shall I say at least substitute magic, the visual and audible presentation of imaginary men in a story. The radical distinction between all art, including drama, that offers a visual presentation and true literature is that it imposes one visible form. Literature works from mind to mind and is thus more progenitive. It is at once more universal and more poignantly particular. If it speaks of wine or bread or stone or tree, it appeals to the whole of these things, to their ideas. Yet each hearer will give to them some form in his own mind. Should a story say he ate bread, the dramatic producer or painter can only show a piece of bread according to his taste of fancy. But the hearer will think of bread in general and will picture it in some form of his own. If a story says he climbed a hill and saw a river in the valley below, the illustrator may catch or nearly catch his own vision of such a scene, yet each hearer of the words will have his own picture of it. And that picture would include all hills, all rivers, all dales that he has ever seen, but especially the hill, the river, the valley, which were for him the first embodiment of the word. For this precise reason, that the characters and even the scenes in drama are not imagined, but actually beheld, drama is, though it uses similar material, words, verse, plot, and art fundamentally different from narrative art. If you prefer drama to literature, as many literary critics plainly do, or form your critical theories from dramatic critics or even from drama, you are apt to misunderstand pure storytelling. You are apt even to prefer characters, even the basest and dullest, to things. Very little about trees as trees can be got into a play. Now, fairy drama, those plays which, according to abundant records, the elves have often presented to men, fairy drama can produce fantasy with a realism or immediacy beyond the compass of any human mechanism. As a result, its usual effect upon a man is to go beyond secondary belief. If you are to find yourself present at a fairy drama, a drama spun by elves, you yourself are, or think that you are, bodily inside its secondary world. The experience is very similar to dreaming, and has, it would seem, sometimes by men being confounded with it. But in fairy drama, you are inside a dream that some other mind is weaving, and the knowledge of this alarming fact may slip from your grasp. To experience directly a secondary world, the potion is too strong. Could you give to it primary belief? However marvelous its events, you are deluded. Whether that is the intention of the elves, always or at any time, is another question. They, at least themselves, are not deluded. We need a word for this elvish craft. But all the words that have been applied to it have been blurred and confused with other things. Magic is ready to hand, but magic should be reserved for the operation of the magician. I prefer the word enchantment. Enchantment produces a secondary world inside which both designer and spectator can enter to the satisfaction of their senses while they are inside. But in its purity, it is artistic in design and purpose. Magic, by contrast,
produces or pretends to produce an alteration in the primary world. It does not matter by whom it is said to be practiced, fey or mortal. Its desire is power in this world, the domination of things and wills. Magic remains not an art, but a technique. But to the elvish craft, enchantment, fantasy aspires. And when it is successful, it is one of the most potent forms of literary art. Unlike magic, it does not seek power, nor delusion, nor bewitchment, but shared enrichment. Partners in making and delight, not slaves. Now, to many, fantasy, this sub-creative art which plays such tricks with the world, combining nouns and redistributing adjectives, has seemed suspect, if not illegitimate. To some, it is at least a childish folly, a thing for peoples or persons in their youth. As to its legitimacy, I will merely quote from a letter that I once wrote to a friend of mine who called myth and story-making lies. But to do him justice, he was kind enough and confused enough to call fairy story-making breathing a lie through silver. This man was my friend Jack. You know him as C.S. Lewis. I will now quote to you from a poem I wrote to him. "Dear sir," I said, "although now long estranged, man is not wholly lost nor wholly changed. Disgraced he may be, yet is not dethroned, and keeps the rags of lordship once he owned. Man, sub-creator, the refracted light through whom is splintered from a single white to many hues and endlessly combined in living shapes that move from mind to mind. Though all the crannies of the world we filled with elves and goblins, though we dared to build gods and their houses out of dark and light, and sowed the seed of dragons, 'twas our right, used or misused. That right has not decayed. We make still by the law in which we're made. We are sub-creators because he is a creator, and we are made in his image and likeness. And so we have a great boon and an obligation in this gift to produce fantasy and in the imagination. But we makers who are made live in a tired and cynical age, don't we? We have grown ill. We need recovering. We should look at green again and be startled anew by blue and yellow and red. We should suddenly meet the centaur and the dragon, and then perhaps behold, like the ancient shepherds, sheep and dogs and horses and wolves. This recovery, fairy stories help us to make. In that sense, only a taste for them may make us or keep us childish. Recovery, which includes return and a renewal of health, is a regaining of a clear view. We need to clean our windows so that the things seen clearly may be freed from the drab blur of triteness and familiarity, from possessiveness. For this triteness is really the penalty of appropriation. The things that have become trite or in a bad sense familiar to us are things we have appropriated, legally or mentally. We say we know them. They are like the things that once attracted us by their glitter or their color or their shape, and we laid hands on them and locked them in our hoard, acquired them, and acquiring them ceased to look at them. Of course, fairy stories are not the only medium of recovery. Humility is enough. And there is, especially for the humble, Moorafolk, or Chestertonian fantasy. Moorafolk, Mooreffoc, is a fantastic word. It can be found written up in every town in this land. It is coffee room,
viewed from the inside, through a glass door, backwards. As it was seen by Dickens on a dark London day, and it was used by Chesterton to connote the queerness of things seen suddenly from a new angle, which becomes the gateway to recovery. Now, I've spoken of two of the four aspects that I mentioned, fantasy and recovery. I will now conclude with the final two, escape and consolation, which are, of course, closely connected. Although fairy stories are, of course, by no means the only medium of escape, they are one of the most obvious and some outrageous forms of so-called escapist literature. It is thus necessary to attach to a consideration of them some consideration of the use of this term escape in criticism generally. I have claimed that escape is one of the main functions of fairy stories, and since I do not disapprove of them, it is plain that I do not accept the tone of scorn and pity with which the word escape is today so often used by literary critics. We are faced with a misuse of words and a confusion of thought. Why should a man be scorned if, finding himself in prison, he tries to get out and go home? Or if, when he cannot do so, he thinks and talks about other topics than jailers and prison walls? The world outside has not become less real because the prisoner cannot see it. In using escape in this way, the critics are confusing, not always by sincere error, the escape of the prisoner and the flight of the deserter. Just so a party spokesman might have labeled departure from the misery of the Führers or any other Reich, and even criticism of it, as treachery. And if we leave aside for the moment fantasy, I do not think that the reader or maker of fairy stories need even be ashamed of the so-called escape of archaism, of preferring not dragons, but horses, castles, sailing ships, bows and arrows, not only elves, but knights and kings and priests. For it is, after all, possible for a reasonable man, after some reflection quite unconnected from fairy story or romance, to arrive at the condemnation of progressive things like factories, or the machine guns and bombs that appear to be their most natural and inevitable, dare we say, inexorable products. It is part of the essential malady of such days, producing the desire to escape, not indeed from life, but from our own age and self-made misery, that we are all acutely conscious both of the ugliness of our works and of their evil. So that to us, evil and ugliness seem indissolubly aligned. We have difficulty conceiving evil and beauty together. The fear of the beautiful Fae, which ran through the elder ages, almost eludes our grasp. And even more alarming, goodness these days is now bereft of its proper beauty. In fairyland, one can indeed conceive of an ogre who possesses a castle hideous as a nightmare, because the evil of the ogre wills it so. But one cannot conceive of a house built with a good purpose, an inn, a hostel for travelers, the hall of a virtuous and noble king that is yet sickeningly ugly, but at the present day, it would be rash to hope to see one that was not. Unless it was built before our time. And so we have frustrations in the secondary world of fairyland and in the primary world that we live in everywhere. But my friends, we also have consolations. And in fairyland, the most mysterious consolation of all, the joy of the happy ending. Almost, I would assert that all complete fairy stories must have it. At least I would say that tragedy is the true form of drama, its highest function, but the opposite is true of fairy stories. And since we do not appear to possess a word that expresses this opposite, I will use the word eucatastrophe. E-U-C-A-T-A-S-T-R-O-P-H-E. Eucatastrophe. The eucatastrophic tale is the true form of fairy tale. Its highest function. The consolation of fairy stories. The joy of the happy ending, or more properly, of the good catastrophe. The sudden joyous turn
for there is no true end to any fairy tale. This joy, which is one of the things fairy stories can produce supremely well, is not essentially escapist nor fugitive. In its fairy tale or other world setting, it is a sudden, miraculous grace, never to be counted on to recur. It does not deny the existence of discatastrophe, of sorrow, and failure, for the possibility of these is necessary to the joy of deliverance. It denies, against much evidence, if you will, universal final defeat. And insofar, it is Evangelium, the good news, the gospel, giving a fleeting glimpse of joy. Joy beyond the walls of the world. Poignant as grief. It is the mark of a good fairy story, of the higher or more complete kind, that however miraculous its events, however wild or terrible its adventures, it can give to child or man that hears it when the sudden turn comes. Of the breath, a beat and lifting of the heart, near to or indeed accompanied by tears, as keen as that given by any form of literary art, and possessing a peculiar quality. Even modern fairy stories can produce this effect sometimes. It is not an easy thing to do. It depends upon the whole story that is the setting of the turn. And yet in such stories, when the sudden turn comes, we get a piercing glimpse of joy and heart's desire that for the moment passes outside the frame, rends indeed the very web of story, and lets a gleam come through. 7 long years I served for thee, the glassy hill I clamped for thee, the bloody shirt I rang for thee. Will thou not waken and turn to me? He heard and turned to her. The peculiar quality of the joy in successful fantasy is thus a sudden glimpse into the underlying reality or truth. It is not a consolation for the sorrow of this world, but a satisfaction and an answer to that question, is it true? The answer to this question, which I gave earlier, was quite rightly, if you had built your little world well, yes, it is true in that world, that is enough for the artist, or the artist part of the artist. But in the eucatastrophe, we see in a brief vision that the answer may be greater. It may be a glimpse into something far greater. Because you see, it is more than merely a glimpse of something that man has made. It is a glimpse into a much greater and far deeper satisfaction, something beyond the endless defeat of human history. It is Evangelium. And with the use of this word, twice now, meaning the good news, the gospel, I give a hint at my epilogue and at the mysterious conclusion of this lecture. Because you see, in approaching the Christian story from this direction, it has long been my feeling, indeed a joyous feeling, that God redeemed the corrupt making creatures, men, in a way fitting to this aspect as to others of his strange nature. Because, my friends, the Gospels contain a fairy story, or a story of a larger kind which embraces all the essence of fairy stories.
They contain many marvels, peculiarly artistic, beautiful and moving, and among the marvels is the greatest and most complete conceivable you catastrophe, happy ending, sudden, joyous turn. But this story has entered history and the primary world. The desires and aspiration of sub-creation, of men writing fiction and fairy tales, has been raised to the fulfillment of creation. The birth of Christ is the eucatastrophe of man's history. The resurrection is the eucatastrophe of the story of the incarnation. This story begins and ends in joy, and it has preeminently the inner consistency of reality. There is no tale ever told that men would rather find was true, and none which so many skeptical men have accepted as true on its own merits. For the art of it has the supremely convincing tone of primary art, that is, of creation. To reject it leads either to sadness or to wrath. And it would not be difficult to imagine the peculiar excitement or joy one would feel if any specially beautiful fairy story were found to be primarily true, true in the real world, its narrative to be history without thereby necessarily losing the mythical or allegorical significance it had possessed. The joy would have exactly the same quality as that joy which the turn in a fairy story gives. Such joy has the very taste of primary truth. The joy of the sudden, eucatastrophic turn in a fairy story looks forward to the great eucatastrophe that is real. This story, the gospel, is supreme, and it is true. Art has been verified. God is the Lord of angels and of men and of elves. With Christ, legend and history have met and fused. But in God's kingdom, the presence of the greatest does not depress the small. Redeemed man is still man. Story, fantasy, still go on and must go on. The Christian has still to work with mind as well as body, to suffer, hope, and die. But he may now perceive that all his bents and faculties have a purpose which can be redeemed. God has redeemed our imagination and desire to create fiction. So great is the bounty with which man has been treated that he may now fairly dare to guess that in fantasy he may actually assist in the effoliation and multiple enrichment of creation. Our desire to create, our imagination, has been redeemed and made valuable by God himself. And now we know that all tales may come true. And yet, at the last, redeemed, they may be as different as the forms that we give them, as man, himself redeemed, will be as different then from the fallen we know now. Young people, do not give up your imaginations, because God has shown us a far greater happy ending than we could ever imagine, and he allows us the glory to sub-create as he created us.
And now, Mr. Kevin O'Brien.
I feel so embarrassed that I happen to be wearing the same thing as J.R.R. Tolkien. down, you know, ladies, you know what that's like. You show up at a party and you're wearing the same dress as someone. This lecture that Tolkien wrote, he delivered as a lecture, and then he expanded it and published it in a book that all the Inklings put together after the death of Charles Williams. And so it's available online, which is how I found it, and then I took the lecture and narrowed it down to about 35 to 40 minutes, however long that was. It's a much more academic lecture. In it, he goes into great detail into some very obscure fairy stories, particularly the stories from the North. And so there's a lot of literary criticism in it that would probably be a little too dry for a fun event like this. But as you can see, in the midst of it, there's this tremendous vision of what the imagination really is about. I teach for Homeschool Connections. I love Homeschool Connections. We've got Catholic homeschoolers all over the country. I'm on a webcam, usually in different costumes, with a green screen behind me with different scenes based on what I'm teaching. And then I have these students, Catholic students all over the country. I teach everything I teach from a profoundly Catholic perspective. So that's good, you know? I mean, we just heard about education. That's a lot of what we're going to hear about, I think, this weekend. So it's one of the things that's reforming the culture is reaching out to young people. One of the things I'm going to be doing is teaching a class this summer and then doing a one-man show at Aquinas College in the fall as part of the Center for Faith and Culture of the spirituality of J.R.R. Tolkien. If you read his letters, you can see that in the same way that The Lord of the Rings is sort of the tip of the iceberg, and with the Silmarillion and everything else, you've got this vast imaginary world that supports The Lord of the Rings, and the several thousand pages is just really the tip of the iceberg. In the same way, Tolkien as a writer and as a man had this vast base of profoundly orthodox Christian belief. His faith is what made him the writer he was and the man that he was. And therefore, fellow Christians, even though we suffer, and even though we have all of this nonsense that we're dealing with in the world, persecution, trouble in the church, I don't know if you noticed there's trouble in the church, even though we have all of this stuff that we're dealing with, here's the deal, here's the thing. He was a sinner, but he was a man of great faith who tried his best to be a good Christian. And from that came probably the greatest work of fiction of the 20th century. I'm leaving G.K. Chesterton aside, who's of course a much better writer. But in Tolkien's case, there's nothing that has grabbed people the way The Lord of the Rings has. But that's the fruit of, as the Protestants would say, his walk with Jesus. And so, be encouraged, because he did what he did through prayer, through self-sacrifice, through faith, and through the cross. It didn't just come out of nowhere. Tolkien, the man and the writer, had a great, vast rhizome, a root underneath him, and he was part of the great vine that is Jesus Christ. Thank you for listening, and God bless. We'll see you soon.